tales from the coma ward here. Just given some play-by-play descriptions of what it's like to wake up from our coma of forgetfulness. Actually, it's very interesting. Particularly, everything's interesting. Everything's exactly the same, except I'm able to see the ego, its tricks that has been tricking me for so long. And see why the whole thing is all, sort of seeing it all as was one complex. And that's super interesting, because you're literally seeing why you've been suffering. That must interest people, right? Why have I been suffering? Why am I been tricked? Why am I here? Why am I... Now, the big one, all right, the big one. What's the big one? As far as this world right now, in the... I don't know if I should say. Get me into trouble with some people. Do I have even the energy to take this on? But when you see it, you laugh. It's just, oh, of course. Getting to the real key insights is a lot of work. You really have to get a right foundation for that. For example, during the 70s, there was this whole consciousness-raising movement, and we were all engaged, so many people were engaged in encounter sessions, all sorts of truth. We were so into saying, hey, this is what's inside me, this is what's inside me, this is what's, you know, we brought to light, we were trying to bring to light up all our hang-ups, we call it, our hang-ups and our troubles and everything. And we actually went quite far with that, even to the point of recognizing that we were setting ourselves up. Everything that was happening to us, we were making it happen. Everything. And this involved, you know, some tremendous honesty on the part of everyone here, men and women, saying, wow, I see how I'm causing everything to happen to myself. It's not happening from some source out there. You know, it's very, very advanced, great progress. But what happened was we didn't have the strong enough foundation to support those kind of insights. It was based on psychology. And we felt that psychology was it. So we took psychology as far as we could go. What happened was a tremendous backlash, because the ego said, hey, wait a minute. If you keep seeing this, the whole egoic paradigm is going to collapse. You can't have that. You know, how can you integrate truth and lies then? If you don't have lies, how can you integrate them with truth? You need lies. And the ego is a tremendous backlash. And everybody that was involved in being very truthful and honest about what their purpose and was, and what they were doing, how they manipulated circumstances to get what they wanted, even if it was like very bad stuff. You know, victimization. We saw that victimization came from our own psyche, that we projected that out and managed to arrange, put ourselves in a situation where we'd be victimized, and it was serving some purpose. And we knew that we were doing it, but we weren't sure what purpose it was serving. So psychology did not have sufficient answers. So the backlash came, and basically we've been buried ever since the 70s. Now, 35 years or so we've been buried by the backlash. Maybe 33. Long time. And all of this openness, there's a time when people are very open and honest and taking responsibility and saying, it's not you, it's me. No, it's not you, it's me. You know, I'm okay, you're okay, but it's you're not to blame. I forgive you, you're not to blame. I'm responsible for what I'm experiencing. So, unfortunately, it was buried. And we're only now, after all these years, digging out from that blizzard, that blitzkrieg, actually. And the landscape is very different when we climb out from underneath that avalanche. We look around and say, oh my God, you know, the landscape's very different, actually. Come out of a coma of forgetfulness. But now it's different. It's different because we have the full foundation. The full foundation is there. Like in my case, the foundation is there. So it's able to handle every kind of insight easily. Structurally, it's easy. The foundation isn't buckling and tipping and having trouble with all this stuff. There's no trouble at all. I think that's the shock. It's like you have these insights and I find there's no trouble at all. No trouble at all. Just quiet. I'm not getting anxiety attack. Nothing. Just fine. Just wow. I can handle this. Easy. Right foundation. Right foundation. We tried to build the house on a bad foundation back then. And, you know, we suffered the consequences of that. Fortunately, we got help. We got help. For me, the curriculum that helped me was A Course in Miracles. And what it did was lay the right foundation. School me in the right foundation. The right context. Understanding the full picture. And from then on, it's a matter of just realizing, hey, it's safe to wake up. It's safe to wake up. Now we, you know, be able to handle the backlash or avoid the backlash. And I think it's just that, you know, the ego thinks that it's got us scared and we can't never handle it. We'll never be able to handle it. But we can. I mean, I know I can, but I'm still kowtowing to the pressure and people because from past experience, how they're able to, you know, rock the boat too much and make me, you know, back away, back down, etc. I don't think it's going to happen now. I mean, what exactly does the ego have for ammunition? So, it's trying its best. It says, hey, you don't want to get addicted to truth. That's not healthy. That's not right. You don't want to become dependent on reality, do you? That's a bad thing, being dependent on reality. Stuff like this. It's very humorous to hear the ego say this stuff. You don't want to be dependent on reality. Overly dependent on reality is not good. You need to balance. You need to have a balance. The ego loves this term, balance. What kind of balance is there in reality? Is reality balancing with what? With unreality? There's some kind of balance? The ego warns us, don't take it too far. Be careful. You don't want to get over dependent on truth and reality. And no, it's dangerous trend. You don't want to. You're gonna lose your ability to balance truth and lies, balance reality and illusions. And see, that's what the ego is concerned about. Doesn't want us to be overly dependent on reality. So the ego says, wow, if you go into the vision of oneness, you're going to lose your balance. I said, lose my balance? There's nothing to balance. There isn't any balance issue. How can I lose my balance if there isn't even any balance issue? Everything is equally abiding. Where's the balance issue? There's no balance issue. Oscillation, same thing. you need the oscillation. You need to get used to oscillation. And now, there's no oscillation in oneness. There's not something moving into oneness and something moving out of oneness, out of everywhereness. Is everywhereness oscillating with non-everywhereness? Is it balancing with non-everywhereness? No, 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 no. So these things the ego says now are just like absurd, totally absurd, and just like, huh? This is what's been in control. It's what's in control of our lives is really absurdity, total absurdity. And we forgot to laugh. We forgot to laugh at it. So you gotta chuckle at it. Don't get overly dependent on reality. Really. Why am I going somewhere else? Is there somewhere else to go? The ego thinks there is. So that's what happens in waking up from the coma, is you just notice these admonitions of the ego and say, whoa, 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 wait a minute. Wait a minute. The ego says, you better not wake up too far. If you wake up anymore, you might start getting overly dependent on truth. You might get overly dependent on vision of oneness. Be moderate about it. Don't do too much of that, you know. Not too much vision of oneness. Don't want to be addicted to it. The ego says everything in moderation, a little bit of truth, a little bit of lies. You know, don't have all truth. That's not good for you. This is his advice. Now, we've done some very foolish things, actually. Very silly things, for sure. Some of them have been institutionalized, actually. And they're still very prevalent. We're coming up on Lent tomorrow. Tomorrow is Lent. Wednesday is Lent. What is Lent? Ash Wednesday. The Lenten season starts with Ash Wednesday. And it's a time of fasting and prayer for 40 days before the crucifixion. Okay, on Easter. Well, Good Friday is the crucifixion. Easter is the resurrection. Now, it's a very timely thing to talk about this. And if you're, you know, if you're Christian, a lot of people are Christians, and this is something that's like nails on chalkboard almost. If you don't have the right foundation, you won't be able to understand it. If you do have the right foundation, you say, of course, it's so obvious, it's incredible. The crucifixion and the resurrection go together. They're one teaching lesson. But what the ego has done is it always advises us incorrectly. And yet because of the continuity problem, we follow its advice. In fact, we think we make a god of the ego. You see, we make a god of the ego. The ego is really just our projection, a projected will. Thinking that our will is outside of us with more power than our will, overpowers our will, controls us, able to control us. So we think the ego's greater than us. We think the ego is God. We think the ego's God. We worship the ego as God. It's really self-worship. It's our own will we're worshiping. But because we wanted to be greater than God, we projected our will, and we now believe that there's some will greater than ours that is controlling our lives. And since our will and God's will are one, what we're really saying is there's some will greater than God's. And we worship that will, and we call that will God, even though it's not the real God. But it's really the ego. It's really the ego. Now, what does the ego really want for us? I can tell you, I've told you before, it wants our annihilation. Because it sees us as a total threat to it, because we told the ego that it's separate from us and has a more powerful will. And deep down, the ego knows this is a lie. You know, it feels that it's really not powerful, and it's totally insecure. Why? It's not a separate will. It's our will. It's one will projected. So there really is no separate ego. But we're telling the ego it is separate. So the ego says, my gosh, I feel threatened, so threatened by annihilation. I got to get rid of my maker. The one that made me is trying to annihilate me by dropping the projection, right? By awakening and dropping the projection. No more ego. So the ego is really trying to annihilate its maker, just as we try to uncreate creation. See, we want on a whim, we wanted to be greater than God. We said, God created everything. He says, now, I wonder if we can uncreate everything. All right? So this is the desire we have. It gives rise to projection of our will, seeming that there's something has the power to uncreate us, bring about our death. Okay? Bring about our death. Now, the ego wants our death to be permanent, because that's the only way it feels that it can survive. Because as long as we're alive, we have the capacity to decide we don't want to keep projecting our will. Poof! Gone. Goodbye, mirage of the ego. No more ego. So it says, if I can just get rid of this threat permanently, then I'll be safe and happy. Everything will be fine. Everything will be fine. Now, the ego is very nasty towards us because it feels threatened by us. We don't realize this. And those who pray to the ego as God are always saying, God, why are you tormenting me? Why are you causing me so many problems? Why are you attacking, this is the Jehovah God, the lustful, angry, ferocious God who throws thunderstorms and plagues and punishes my enemies and punishes me if I don't do right. And this terrible, wrathful deity. That's the ego. That's our own projected will. It's not God. And we're trying to appease this God, saying, God, what can we do to appease you? You know, you're so harsh on us. It seems like nothing we can do can please you enough. And always we're dying. And it seems like, we just need a better relationship with you, God. We're really praying to the ego there. That's our own projected will, based on our whimsical desire to uncreate creation. The real God is the everywhereness that is totally untouched by all our crazy fantasies, that is totally, perfectly supportive of everything that happens. Everything that is completely blessed by God at all times. That is the real God. There's not the tiniest bit of anger or insecurity or fear or punishment or anything like that. It's absolute total love and serenity and peace and blessings and sacredness eternally. That is the real God. Not this wrathful, insecure, punitive ego God that we're worried about. But because this ego God seems to be controlling our lives, all right, seems to be, we seem powerless, over all these circumstances, right, that the body encounters. We try to appease this and say, whatever you want, God, whatever you want, just tell us what we need to do. Well, the ego says, there's one thing that you could do that's going to solve all your problems. And we said, well, we're all ears. Please tell us. There's one thing. And what do you think that is? What do you think the ego wants more than anything to solve its problems? See, the ego says, I'm cranky. I'm a cranky God and insecure. I punish you sometimes, but you can do one thing that will appease my wrath forever. And we say, oh my gosh, what is that? Please tell me what that is. Any clues about what that is? When you say it, you'll just say, oh, my, of course. And I'll straighten it out. Don't worry, I will put it in the right context for you. So don't knee-jerk react too much here. What the ego wants, what the ego thinks will calm its insecurities and its wrath, is our eternal death, the eternal death of spirit. That's exactly what it wants. And it says, if you could just give me that gift, I will take it easy on you. So what happens? Jesus is born in the world. And what do? We kill Jesus. Okay? We kill the spirit. The body. We kill the body. And the ego says, oh my, he says, ah, oh, that's wonderful. That's absolutely wonderful. You did what I asked. You know, I sent my favorite, my only favorite son, so you could kill my son, that son, so I would never have to be bothered by that spirit again. I'm free, I'm happy. Well, okay, that's the crucifixion. Then what happened? The resurrection. And ego said, uh-oh, you didn't keep him dead. You're supposed to keep him dead. He came back to life. You know, what's going on here? The ego's like, what? So, what happened there with Jesus in the crucifixion and resurrection? Jesus was not sent by the ego. The ego claimed that Jesus was sent by the ego, what we think is God. Now, Jesus was sent by the real God, the God of love. And the God of love, the God of perfect omnipresence, allowed Jesus to teach us a lesson here. Jesus wanted to teach this lesson. He said, this would be very helpful. So, what Jesus did is he said, I want to show you, everyone here, what your agenda is. I want to show you what your purpose is for all this. I want to make it unmistakable for you. Okay. So he allowed this, what's called the passion play, stations of the cross. He allowed us to serve our God's interests, the ego, the God that we are, the idol, the idol God, not the true God, but the idol God, the God that we have, that we're idolizing, which is the ego. He allowed that to have its say. Once he had done his ministry here, he said, okay, now I'm going to let the ego do what it wants to with me, and you'll see what will happen. And of course, those close to him were absolutely blown away. I mean, just, I can't even imagine what it was like to see that their rabbi, the Son of God, being crucified. I mean, it's just like, are you kidding me? How could this happen? It's just a mind blower, really. I hard to even contemplate. And then they all thought, that's it. He's dead. Dead forever. That's it. The ego, you know, has prevailed here. Killed the Son of God. And, of course, the other people are saying, that's great. That's great. The one of the dead, they said, okay, now we have made the sacrifice, the ultimate sacrifice that you asked for, ego God. He said, you asked for the sacrifice to appease your wrath, and now we've given it to you. Now you're going to be happy forever after, right? You're not going to be angry ever again, right? And that's what they're hoping for. I said, okay, we kept our part of the deal. We killed Jesus. We killed Spirit. Then the resurrection happened. And of course, those close to Jesus were like, what? Are you kidding me? I mean, that would shock anybody. That was, could you imagine that some you see someone's crucified and dead and buried, and then later you see them completely well and walking around the world, it's just like, whoa, bells ringing, like, that's a very heavy lesson, really. I don't know why Jesus decided to teach that lesson. That's up to him and the Holy Spirit, but that's a heavy lesson, really, very. And he said, okay, school's in session now, folks. You need to understand what happened, right? Go to work. You have your object lesson. You have your teaching moment. You know, I'm going to leave now so you can work on this, because you're going to need a lot of work on this, believe me. You might need several thousand years of working on this. Yeah. Yep, and we're still working on it, aren't we? Now, what the ego said was, huh, the ego's like, uh-oh, I got a problem here. I can't keep Spirit dead, and people have seen that now. In fact, they've seen that you can't kill Spirit. And So my request, you know, they're onto it. This really messes, this makes it things very difficult. And so ego was worried, but it said, look, what this always does, split the two, truth and lies, and says, okay, the crucifixion, he said, just take that as itself. And just say that God wanted his only beloved son to come into the world so he could be murdered. And okay? And so that would appease God's anger. Completely nuts, right? I don't understand that at all. But he said, let's just take that as we made the sacrifice, and now God is happy with us. And let's just leave it at that. And, you know, we were able, just believe that we were able to kill the Son of God, and now the God ego is happy, saying that you're loyal, you're faithful to the ego. No more insecurity for the ego. That's what the ego's teaching, no more insecurity. And then it says, well, just take the resurrection thing as something separate from the crucifixion. And it says, oh, you see, Jesus came back, and we're happy that he's resurrected, and okay, fine, and just whatever you want to do with that, you know, he's risen from the dead, and but the ego says, okay, whatever you want to make with that, of that, but this is separate from the crucifixion. And then the ego says, okay, now you got to blend the two, you know, blend the two conclusions, two separate conclusions, two separate purposes, then make them compatible like that. And so that's where we've got this problem with institutionalized dogma and the way things are being taught. It's not one understanding. It's the ego's understanding, and then whatever the ego says, the Holy Spirit's understanding, and then the attempt to blend the two, make them compatible. That's not it. It's not it. It's not being taught properly. It was one object lesson. It was to say, this, your purpose, the God that you're serving is the ego, and that God wants spirit to be eternally dead. That's its purpose. And I'm showing you this. I'm representing spirit in this passion play. And I'm going to show you what the ego wants to happen to spirit. The ego wants spirit dead forever. Okay. Then I'm going to show you that spirit cannot die. The body can die, but spirit cannot die. Therefore, it's a waste of time. Worshiping this God, the ego God, is a waste of your time, because you can never please it. You can never give it what it wants. So you better start realizing this, what it really wants, and that you can't give it to it. So what's the use then of even trying? And Jesus said there's another way. And then refers us to his teachings. He says, look, you got to pay attention to what I taught you, and to realize what's going on. And then he said, the Holy Spirit will clarify everything for you. Okay? Just listen to the Holy Spirit. He'll clarify everything. I did my part. I gave this teaching an object lesson. Let the Holy Spirit explain this object lesson, this teaching moment that I gave to you, you know, the crucifixion and resurrection together. What the ego really wants, what its purpose is to annihilate spirit, and it cannot annihilate spirit. Spirit cannot be annihilated. Death of the body does not mean the death of the flesh. I mean, the death of the flesh does not mean the death of spirit, okay? Does not, spirit cannot die. So what happened was, as always, we asked the ego for its advice on how to deal with this. And as always, the ego misadvised us and said, sure, just realize that you made the perfect sacrifice, which is what God wanted you to sacrifice his son and in order to appease his wrath towards us. And now God feels that we're good loyalists, you know, very loyal, and we'll won't be so angry at us, because we won't fire up God's insecurity by our disloyalty. So we'll be sure to say, oh yes, you know, absolutely, we crucified Jesus. That's absolutely right. And we accepted that. You know, we accept that that's what you wanted. And okay, we're not arguing with that. That's fine. just hoping, you know, that the ego doesn't, you know, get all crazy on us, as it always does. And we miss out on what the purpose of the whole lesson really is all about. The ego is plotting our annihilation every moment. That's its secret agenda. How can the ego annihilate spirit so that spirit cannot withdraw this projection of will, right? That's the ego's completely obsessed with that, but it doesn't let us know that. And it offers us all these compromise things. It says, you need to work on this and this and this. It knows this won't work. It's a delaying tactic. Everything the ego does is delaying tactic. It says, why don't you work on integrating truth and lies? Why don't you work on making them compatible? Why don't you work on this, this? It's just buying time. All the ego does is buy time. That's it. It buys time so it can try to figure out, how do I kill spirit and keep it dead forever? How do I give eternal death to spirit? That's what it's always after. And Jesus brought that to light. Brought it to light. Said, look, this is what's going on. As we're told, the ego is a liar and a deceiver and a murderer from the very beginning. It absolutely is. It wishes its maker nothing but the worst ill will possible, because it feels that its maker made it totally vulnerable to annihilation, and so it hates its maker. Our projected will hates us, you know, and to cure it, the cure is to stop projecting. The cure is to stop projecting. Vision and oneness cures us. It cures us. Only the vision and oneness cures. There we see no projection at all. Everything is equally abiding in the pure heart of every awareness. And there's no projection taking place. No ego. So I don't know, that whole lesson is so off the charts, you know. It's hard to relate to it. And I certainly don't advise anybody to attempt that. You know, let Jesus do that one. Forget about it. As far as us doing it like that, forget about it. No way. No way. That's a slippery slope, actually. And, you know, Jesus actually complained in A Course in Miracles that he says that everyone here in the world has made such a terrible mess of it, and idols of all this stuff. It just got it all mixed up and messed up. And, wow, you know. Well, yeah. Of course, the ego, of course, the continuity problem is going to cause that, for sure. For sure. But Jesus does a fantastic job of clarifying everything for us in A Course in Miracles. Fantastic job if you have the eyes and ears to understand it, and the dedication and the patience and the hard work and determination to process all this stuff. It's not easy because of our continuity problem. So what we really have is a continuity problem. This is the teaching I've come up with, and to me it's the most stable teaching there is. And if we could turn the whole spiritual paradigm towards just the continuity problem, we would save uncountable time, delay, uncountable delay, virtually unmeasurable delay, if we could do that. It's just this tremendous centering device where you don't feel like you have to be crucified or martyred or go through any problems, actually. Because we only have the continuity problem. What we do is we exchange all problems for just the continuity problem. And what we say to the Holy Spirit is, Holy Spirit, I don't have this problem. I don't have a financial problem. I have a continuity problem. I literally don't have it, okay? But I do agree to have a continuity problem, which means I do agree to dwell in a world, in a place. I do agree to be here because in order to resolve the continuity problem. But I don't agree to have any other problem. So give all those problems to the Holy Spirit. If people want to have financial problems, the Holy Spirit's going to have to deal with them. If people want to have problems of any kind, the Holy Spirit has to deal with them. I'm not going to deal with any of that because I don't have that problem. I decided I don't have any problem except the continuity problem. That's ascensional. That frees us. It is an attitude of ascension that is just completely profound, actually. And so I'm just sticking with this. Only problem I have is a continuity problem. That's it. I don't have any existence problem. I don't have any problem except a continuity problem. And that, Holy Spirit, I will focus on. The other stuff, I'm not going to focus on at all. No focus. It's your problem, Holy Spirit. Put it on you. And that's fine with the Holy Spirit. Once we just accept the continuity problem is the only problem we have, you know, we are so far along, it's just tremendous. The Holy Spirit can deal with any problem at all problems, but we don't need to deal with those problems. In other words, if we decide that we only have a continuity problem, we think, wow, I won't be able to relate to those other problems. How can I help people with those other problems? We don't have to. The Holy Spirit will help them with all the worldly problems that they claim they have, all these things. Holy Spirit's perfectly capable of helping everybody with all their needs and problems, etc. But if we say, I don't have those problems, then they don't exist for us. Everything will have to arrange itself so that these problems, we don't have a problem. It's like scarcity. I don't have a scarcity problem. No, I don't have any scarcity problem. We're literally manifesting a paradise for ourselves when we do that. At least we're aligning with it. Maybe our will is not so unified we can manifest a paradise, but we're definitely aligning our will with it. Because in paradise, the only problem is the continuity problem. There isn't any other problem. There's no scarcity problem. There's no security problem, right? There's no loneliness problem. There's no depression problem. There's no fear problem. No survival problem. None of the problems that we experience in this world are there. Only the continuity problem is there. And that is we're not quite yet ready to drop paradise for the pure spaciousness of the knowing, the knowingness. We're still perceiving, which is fine. So the only problem I have is a continuity problem. I don't have any other problem. Is the most powerful statement we can make now, the most practical, pragmatic statement we can make now. The only problem I have is the continuity problem. I don't have an insecurity problem. I only have a continuity problem. I don't have a job problem. I only have a continuity problem. I don't have a housing problem. I only have a continuity problem. That's it. The only problem I have is the continuity problem. Just adamantly insisting upon this is the most powerful practice. And then that gives rise, it produces the right foundation where you can do other practices like this moment just as it is totally free of all specialness. That's another very strong practice. But the continuity practice, I think, is the basic, you know, foundational, super strong practice that enables all the other practices to have their effect on us as also. So it's very important to continue to focus on this continuity problem. Means my only trouble is I'm too afraid to quickly, abruptly wake up from this, drop this whimsical insanity of trying to uncreate creation. I'm too afraid to drop it like that abruptly. That's all that means. And since we've been worshiping the ego as if it was God for so long, you know, that we're confused. We think, oh, I don't want to like, you know, maybe God will be angry with me if I don't accept all the problems God gives me, because we're told that God gives us all these problems and stuff. You know, no, the ego does. The ego does. Why? To delay us, to distract us from right spiritual practice. Because it knows that will lead to the vision of oneness, which will cure us from projection, which means there's no more ego. So, of course, the ego does everything it possibly can think of to distract us from right spiritual practice. Anything and everything. So it gives us all these problems. So we're struggling with all these problems. If we're in paradise, what are we going to do? Right spiritual. What else is there to do? Right spiritual practice. I only have a continuity problem. A vision of oneness. Abide in that. There's no other problems to solve. There's no problems to solve. So easy for us there. But in this world of problems, oh my gosh, the ego loves this world, right? And they say, so God so much loved this world, he gave his only begotten son to be killed here. You see, to try to make this world a permanent hiding place from God. So we believe that this is the place where God's son was killed, the spirit was killed here. And the ego says, wow, you got to come to this world, because this is where the spirit died here. It's such a great place, as the ego says that. Spirit died here. He's going to talk about problems. I mean, this place has got so many problems. You'll never have to do any right spiritual practice if you come to this planet. So, of course, this planet attracts all the flies, right? You know what attracts flies. This planet attracts a lot of flies. Those who think that by coming here, you know, they'll never have to do any right spiritual practice. They'll be permanently cured of any desire to engage in right spiritual practice. That's what they think. So many, many, many spirits who are very frightened of the continuity problem come here, and they think they found the best place. I mean, I love this place here. Everybody's completely crazy. I got so many problems. I can't even I remotely attempt to, you know, do any right spiritual practice. I don't even know what that is. Are you kidding? This is a great place. This is where God's son came to die. You know what? So this is a haven, you know, just a haven. Great place to worship the ego. But without right spiritual practice, you just continue on in this misery. Because you can't die, your spirit, you can't die. So if the demand is you have to continue on with all these problems until you finally learn how to die eternally, then you're going to continue on with these problems ad infinitum, right? I mean, on and on and on and on and on. There's no ending to it until you finally do right spiritual practice and accept the vision of oneness. That's what ends it. Vision of oneness ends the madness. Okay? It ends it. Brings it to an end. Gently. Very peacefully. Smoothly. Gently. Not as eternal death. You see, the ego tells us that the end comes as our eternal death. That's what brings about what the ego wants. The ego wants our eternal death, so we can never give the ego what it really wants. But we can certainly delay and delay and delay. And we'll never be able to give the ego what it wants. That's what the resurrection, the crucifixion and resurrection is pointing out. We'll never be able to give the ego what it really wants. We'll never be able to satisfy it. So it'll just continually give us problems. Continuously, for sure. Why? To prevent us from right spiritual practice. See, we're stuck. Without right spiritual practice, we are stuck. Totally stuck. Because we'll keep turning to the ego. Says, what do you want? Just tell me what you want. I'll give it to you. It wants your eternal death. You can't give that to the ego. So, because you can't give that to the ego then frantically has to distract you from right spiritual practice through all these problems. So you'll just keep heaping more and more problems on you forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. No end to that. Except when you decide right spiritual practice leads you to vision of oneness. Vision of oneness is absolutely cures the whole projection mess. So it's like medicine that has to be taken. For sure. It has to be taken. And what the world does is delays, and the ego loves delay. Anyone who's an expert in delay, the ego says, well, you're my type, you're my hero, my heroine, really heroine. And it says, just, I'm going to put you on top of the world. I'm going to make sure that you have, you know, you're the one who's helping out. So the ego loves those who are expert at delay, puts them in all the prime positions in the world, and says, do your thing, man. I'm going to help you out, help you out, help you out. And that's what we have in this world. Experts in delay, supported by the ego, thinking that they're doing the right thing. Because the ego says, you got to work on these problems until you're really ready to give me what I really need. And everyone says, okay, okay, okay. The ego says, you're not quite ready yet to give me what I really want. So you need to really suffer and get sick and die and go through all these displacements and all this stuff. And, you know, and the ego says, you know, are you getting the hint? What I really want? What I really want? And you say, yeah, I kind of think you really want me to be dead forever. And the ego says, yeah, that's what it really wants. We can't give the ego that. Not able to. It's out of luck. Ego's out of luck. And we're in a bad situation because then we realize, uh-oh, I gotta let go of all this. That's the continuity problem. You see, the ego says, there is no continuity problem. Once you give me what I really want, everything will be fine. Yeah. Because you'd be eternally dead and the ego wouldn't have to give you anything. You see, you wouldn't have to solve any continuity problem. But you cannot give the ego what it really wants. No one can. The ego said that Jesus did. He says, look, you need to follow Jesus' example. He gave me whatever I want. No, because he resurrected from the dead. See, the ego leaves that out, leaves that part out. Resurrected from the dead. And showed us we can't give the ego what it wants. It's impossible. Or the ego leaves that part out. It says, no, you need to follow that example of dying, 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 dying. Try to kill spirit. You know, try to kill your spirit. So, we have to engage in right spiritual practice. Just, you got to drill that into your head. The more you hear this, the closer you get to doing it. You may not want to start it yet. Nobody does. Nobody does. So you're in a big group of people who don't want to start it. Because you don't want to get the ego mad at you. You know that'll get the ego ticked off at you. Betrayal, total betrayal. And the ego say, oh man, you're really going into the darkness, the ego say. You're going crazy, you're going cuckoo, you're over the top, off the charts. How can you say my only problem that I have is a continuity problem? That's totally insane. I've given you so many problems. How can you say that? You know, mamma mia, look at all the problems I have given you. Whatever you name it, if I haven't given you enough problems, let me give you some more. You know, just so you don't have to do this craziness. You're going to become addicted to truth, and it'll be so completely imbalanced. You won't be balanced with lies. How can you do that? You're going to become completely imbalanced. And all this stuff the ego gives us. And it's really kind of funny, but not so funny when you're in the grip of it. But remember to try and laugh about it. That's very powerful medicine, is to have a good laugh at the ego. How utterly silly it really is. Don't take the ego too seriously. But be very aware of what its agenda, objective is. Very aware of it. I would say take it seriously, but also make sure to laugh at the absurdity of its position, because it really is completely absurd. So, we're in a situation where we got our options are set for us. We can't say, well, let me see if I can set a different option. No, our options are set. We either continue trying to give the ego what it wants, or we have to engage in right spiritual practice to gently awaken from our coma of forgetfulness to the vision of oneness, which leads to the vision of oneness, which is this gentle, peaceful awakening. And abiding in this sort of soft awakening, a soft landing. The vision oneness is a soft landing, okay? Very soft landing. That's it. That's our option. Those are our options. Don't have any other options. And the ego tells us, of course you've got other options. That, whoever says you don't have any other options is a knucklehead. Don't listen to them. They're kind of stupid. They're not smart enough to realize your other options. Of course you got options, the ego says. You can make truth and lies compatible. That's an option right there. You can make mutual exclusives compatible. Why don't you work on that, the ego says. And you say, wow, that'll take me a long time. How do you do that? That's a tough one. And the ego says, yeah, but you can do anything. If you can dream it, you can do it, the ego tells you. Yeah, nothing's impossible for you. The ego loves that phrase. Nothing's impossible for you. You can make mutual exclusives compatible, right? Absolutely. Truth and lies, compatible. No problem. You should be able to do it. Go ahead, try. Yeah, what's the matter? You don't think you can do it? Oh, come on. You're a spirit. You can do anything. It's not impossible. So what's the ego really doing? It's saying, I got to keep them from practicing right spiritual practice, the continuity practice. I got to stop that. Because if they start practicing that, I'm finished. That's what the ego's really thinking, feeling. So I am finished. If they start the continuity practice, I am done. I am done. I'm done for. So the ego's desperate to distract us from that. Desperate. So a delay tactics. It's a genius of delay tactics. It has to be. Its survival depends upon it from its standpoint. Of course, it's not a separate will, so there's real nothing there to survive. But we told it it's a separate will, so it believes that. It's the belief system operates as if it were so. It's a belief system. The ego is really just a belief system. That's all it is. But the belief system operates to psych us out. That's its purpose, to psych us out. To maintain the belief system, maintain itself. So, our options are set for us. It's easy, so we just choose which way to go. Shall we keep on accepting the ego's problems for us? And be good little ego worshippers, good idolaters, and say, sure, ego, I understand we need to learn how to solve all these problems. No. I don't need to learn how to solve any problem except the continuity problem. That's what I mean. I don't have that problem. It means I don't need to know how to solve that problem. That's one way of looking at it. I don't need to learn how to solve the survival problem. I only need to learn how to solve the continuity problem. And the continuity problem actually has already been already given. Is vision of oneness is the way to solve the continuity problem. It's already there, perfect for me, waiting for me. It's on my plate. All I have to do is eat it. So I don't have a work problem. I don't have a work problem. I don't have to solve any work problem. The work problem has no value to me. Trying to work on solving the work problem has no value to me. Only solving the continuity problem, resolving the continuity problem has value to me. Only that. Only that. Nothing else. No other problem has any value to me. This is freeing yourself from the ego and turning right in the direction of the vision of oneness. Because the ego will feed you problems forever. Dramas, problems, threats, violence, conflict, turmoil, hopes, fears, insecurities, ups and downs. It'll keep you distracted through your entire life and your next life and your next life after that and on and on and on and on and on for as many lives as you continue to play this game and turn to the ego saying, okay, ego, you're God. I'll follow your advice. As long as we do that, we will get another body and we'll get problems. We'll get problems, whether in this life or the afterlife, the cycles continue. You continue on in a problematical cycle. Because you're still trying to give the ego what it wants. You think you can solve the ego's problem there. No, you cannot. But the only way to solve the ego problem is to stop projecting the ego. It's the only way. And the only way you'll do that is if you first accept the vision of oneness. Okay? Don't try to stop projecting the ego directly. Okay? This is a mistake. And of course, the ego sponsors this. They say, hey, you know, you never hear the ego saying, do right spiritual practice, do you? You never hear the ego saying, only problem is the continuity problem. You never hear the ego saying, the vision of oneness is the resolution to the continuity problem. That only that has value. You never hear the ego saying that, never. But you do hear the ego saying a lot of spiritual stuff. And it loves to sponsor the idea of just stop projecting. The ego says, oh, you got a projection problem? Well, just stop projecting then. Come on, it's easy. Just do it. Right now, stop projecting. Yeah, the ego says, yeah, I'm happy with that. And we say, oh, the ego said, sure, I'd be happy with that, no problem. Well, just do it right now, though, right now. Huh? You say, oh, really, ego? Yeah, no problem with me. Go ahead, do it. Ego's bluffing, right? It doesn't want us to do it, but it knows we won't do it. Because the more we try to push that right now, stop all projection right now, okay? The more that's pushed on us, the more fearful we get. And the more we back away from it, from the vision of oneness, right? Spiritual practice. I say, oh my God, no, it's too much for me. I can't do it. You know, there's a whoa, no. We retreat. We flee from it. We flee from it. The ego knows that. It loves it. That's one of its favorite tricks. Come on. Go instant enlightenment right now. Why not? What's the matter? What are you afraid of? Yeah, it's like saying someone that's in this incredibly deep coma. Say, come on, wake up this instant. Come on, snap out right now. Go back to full functioning this instant. That's what it's like saying. Go back to full functionality instantly, right now. That's what the ego loves to do. The ego loves to play doctor with us. And Dr. Ego says, what's the problem? Comes in the room and here the doctors are trying to slowly, gradually awaken the coma patient through right spiritual practice, leading to the soft landing of the vision of oneness, okay? And the ego comes in the room and, what is this? You call yourself doctors? No problem here. Come on. Hey, patient, snap out of it. Come on. Don't humor this patient. He's in a deep coma. Doesn't need to be any coma. Come out of the coma right now. Come on. Wake up. Like that. And of course, the coma patient, barely hearing this, you know, is trying to wake up and said, oh my gosh, I feel I'm being pressured to snap out of this. And how can I snap out of this coma and function perfectly, you know, just like instantly? It's like, so that then the coma patient frantically tries to deepen their coma. Because they're subconscious, they're hearing this, what the ego's telling them a little bit, you know, that like scares the heck out of them. So Dr. Ego is a very bad doctor. And saying that you're supposed to just instant enlightenment, snap out of it, all your projections, just like that right now, no preparation for whatsoever. That's a very, very, very questionable teaching for sure. I don't know any of the great teachers who said anything like that at all. Shankara did not. Buddha did not. Shankara did not. Jesus did not. Anandamayi did not. Ramana Maharshi did not. And Longchenpa did not. The final Ati Yoga, where you go into the vision of oneness, is a soft landing. So you're not really snapping out of anything at all. I mean, I've already had experience of the dawning of the vision of oneness, and it's just as simple as you just kind of gently have a sort of a meaning shift, a sort of a gentle meaning shift, and like, okay, you know, just super soft, incredibly downy soft landing, and it's just like, that was like, there's no abruptness or anything at all to that. It's like, wow. But I realized, well, this is not the, you know, I didn't totally drop all projections and perception like that. No, I'm still perceiving. The ego wants us to shoot the moon. You know, it says, snap out of this instantly, forever, right this second. Go back to total knowing of all spaciousness, total knowing of a perfect abidance forever. Deep, 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 deep coma of guilt and fear and projection, all stuff. Just do it right this instant. And if you can't do this instant, then you really can't do it. That's the conclusion the ego draws. Says, well, you can't give yourself what you want then, right? You can't do it, can you? And then the ego says, see, it's easier to give me what I want than it is for you to snap out of the coma, see? So you better get back to trying to give me what I want. That's its trick. It wants your eternal death. It says, you can give it to me. You're just holding it back. Come on, give it to me. And we won't do it. The ego says, okay, snap out of, no option but to snap out of your coma this instant. Can you do that? And we say, no. Well, then the ego says, well, I'll tell you what, it's easier to give me what I want than it is to snap out of your coma, isn't it? And we're in such a fearful state, we say, okay, ego, whatever you say, you know, terrifies us. Really, the ego plays hardball. It is a hardballer, let me tell you. Throws at your head, you know, is a mean, mean pitcher out there on the mound. You're going to get knocked down. It's going to try to knock you down for sure. That's vicious stuff. So what the real teachers say is lifetime of effort. Okay, just tell yourself, look, I need a soft landing. I have a severe continuity problem. I need a soft landing. And I'm gonna have to work at it like that and realize it's gonna take a while. Soft landing, I mean, you know, it's going to take a while to lead up to that. Because I need a soft landing, I must be very frightened. Therefore, I've got to work right spiritual practices to help align me and take away my concerns. And then so I can have a very soft landing, which is the vision of oneness. It could be a lifetime of effort. Maybe less than that for some. Maybe some have done a lot of effort in a previous life. Maybe for them it's just a little bit more effort here. But no matter what, whether it's in one life or two or three or whatever, you have to engage in right spiritual practice. That thwarts the ego's trick about saying you got to wake up instantly or not at all. That's a lie. I just showed you what the lie is. The ego says, either wake up instantly or not at all. And if you can't do it right now, it means you're incapable of waking up. Therefore, you got to go back to trying to give the ego what it wants. You don't have any option. It's obviously you can't wake up. That's what the ego is trying to tell us, right? So when you do the right spiritual practice, you're not caught in that dynamic. You say, I don't care. I'm going to wake. I'm going to have a soft landing or vision of oneness, and that's my goal. And we'll take it from there. Ego, I say, well, we'll take it from there. No, it's not the total end of the path. That's okay. I'm having a soft landing. Frees me from my continuity problem. All I'm working on is my continuity problem. I'm not working on enlightenment. Not trying to be enlightened, okay? I'm trying to solve my continuity problem. This really undoes the ego's grip on you. It really does. You are outplaying the ego. You're outplaying them. Absolutely. You're hitting a home run. You're just saying, hey ego, you know, I can't deal with all your problems. I got a way more severe problem. I have a continuity problem. So I'm not accepting any of your problems at all. I'm burdened, totally burdened by this continuity problem, okay? So the other stuff, I refuse. I refuse your problems. I'm not gonna work on them. And I'm not trying to be enlightened or you know, the savior, anything. I just need to resolve this terrible continuity problem I have. That's it, I'm just working on that. Not trying to be enlightened at all. I'm not trying to be some enlightened, radiant, enlightened bodhisattva or something. No. I'm just going for the soft landing into the vision of oneness. That's it. That's all I'm aiming for, ego. Ego doesn't have much to say about that. You know, it's just disgusted with you, for sure. Because it can't use its tricks on you. See, the ego hates you when it can't trick you. When it can't scare you, it hates you. When it can't scare you, when you're terrified, when it can scare you, then ego smiles, says, "Ah, I like you. I like you so much because you're so easily scared. And if you can't be scared, the ego just terrible, terrible, terrible person. What's wrong with them? Hate them, really hate them. They're awful. So you see the benefits of this continuity, with this way of continuity problem, this teaching. I'm seeing it's like incredibly beneficial. Incredibly beneficial. It's hard to get to this because the ego doesn't want us to get to it. It throws every obstacle under the sun in front of your way to try to prevent you from getting to this because it knows this is it for the ego. It's finished. The ego doesn't want to be finished. It thinks it's annihilation. And it thinks it's the annihilation of its maker too, you know. And he says, I'm saving you from annihilation by maintaining this projection. No, it's not. Continuity problem. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful position to be in. See, I'm not saying, hey, I'm enlightened, everybody. I'm enlightened. No. We're saying I'm working on resolving my continuity problem. Now, even when we have the vision of oneness, we'll say, humble, we'll say, I'm inviting the vision of oneness as the remedy for my terrible continuity problem, but it's not solved yet. It's going to take quite some time to wash it all out of my system. You know, it's still the bad taste. You know, is I feel like it. You know, could come back on me. You know, if I don't keep abiding in the vision of oneness, it could come back on me for sure. So I'm just taking my medicine. It's medicine I got to take. I got to take it for the rest of my life, and that's all there is to it. It's the ego that throws around the word enlightenment a lot. We use it sometimes because we're so used to it, right? All these grandiose words, but the ego really uses that to intimidate us. And cause us to turn around and flee back into darkness. It's aiming too high, you know, trying to get us to aim too high, which scares us. Snap out of our coma instantly. The ego says, why take years to come out of your coma? Why don't you just come out this instant? What's the matter with you? You know, if you want it, why don't you just do it? And then we don't do it. The ego says, you see, that's not what you really want. What you really want is to serve the ego and give me what I want. See, that's what you really want. The ego plays with our mind like this and causes us tremendous anguish, really. Tremendous anguish. There's no question, having been through it all, what is it? Anguish, terrible mental anguish the ego causes us through its tricks, just the utmost mental anguish. Because we just feel terrible, because we feel like, I can't do it. That means I really don't want it. So that means I got to keep serving the ego. The ego's right. I have to do what, you know, to accept all these problems it gives me and work through them. And you know there's something wrong, and you just feel, I can't figure it out. You know, I just feel trapped. I just hate this. That's anguish, mental anguish. And the anguish that people go through is just horrible. And a lot of people try to medicate it away in some way. But if you want to succeed, you need to face the anguish. And just say, wow, the ego is giving me this terrible anguish. I have to discover what's the root of this. Otherwise, it's going to keep on going on. And I thought, you know, you think you can outlast it. You know, I just thought for a while, I said, you know, okay, this is my terrible anguish, but it can't last forever. I can just wait until it goes away. It never went away. And at some point, I said, you know what? I really better get working on this double time, because it's not going away. It's getting worse. Because the ego basically told me, you don't really want to wake up. You can't wake up right this instance. That means you can't, you don't want to wake up, which means your desire, telling me that your desire to, is all a lie. You're a phony, and you need to be cured from all your phoniness and deceitfulness and lying and all this stuff, that you really want to wake up, because obviously you're not doing it, so you're a liar. And so I felt like this extreme guilt trip. You're like, wow, I must be a terrible person to lie to the ego. And of course, we think the ego's God, so I'm lying. Am I lying to God? And I think I'm like, just super confused, terrible confusion. I said, I get this. I'm being told I'm lying to God. I'm deceitful, dishonest to God, because I can't wake up. I'm afraid to wake up, and it just becomes this enormous, enormous confusion and mental anguish. Really, it's just awful. It's just the worst. It's just the worst. So. Of course, having been through that, I'm sharing what I know about it, because I don't want anybody to delay within that to rot in that anguish, you know, like I rotted, you know, and it's just because I didn't have the tools to get out of it. I didn't have the foundation to get out of it. Now I do, so it's very important to. Spend your time getting the right foundational context. If you can't do the practices, then you should be studying the context. Absolutely should be studying some curriculum that gives you the right context of the whole thing, the right foundation of it. I know one curriculum that does it. A Course in Miracles definitely does it. Some are able to use the Bible to get the right foundation. And some have, definitely. And there may be other curriculums too, maybe some of the sutras, the Vedas, the yogic sutras, the Buddha teaching, various teachings, whatever. I'm not going to name them all or litany. I'm just saying whatever can give you the right true curriculum, right? The true foundation. You got to study it, but try to do the practices. That'll save you the most time. If you say, just have a continuity problem, that will save you. I mean, if I had known that practice when I was younger, I could have saved myself all this trouble. But the ego had me in this trap where I was defending myself. You know, I was so thinking like, whoa, am I really completely wrong God here? I'm praying to the wrong God. And I really don't want to awaken. Wait a minute. So I got into such a defensive position. The ego put me in such a defensive position. I felt I needed to defend myself, you know? And I was so completely wrapped up into battling with the ego that I didn't use, you know, I wasn't aware of this technique. I could have just said, hey, I don't have an ego problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. I don't have a guilt problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a wrong God problem, ego. I've got a continuity problem. See, ego, I don't have to defend myself. I don't have a defensive problem, ego. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. So I'm not even listening to you. I don't need to listen to you at all or defend anything. See, if I had known that, I would have saved myself a universe of anguish, you know. Absolutely. So, of course, I want to pass this on to everybody, because the sooner you get this, the better it's going to be. Because you'll feel like you don't need to defend yourself. Whatever the ego says doesn't matter, because I don't have that problem. I only have a continuity problem. That's it. That's the only thing I'm working on, ego. And you can't help me, because the Holy Spirit's helped me with that. Because why? Vision of oneness. Right spiritual practice, vision of oneness. That's it. I already have that. See, it's easy. Don't need your help, ego. So, take a hike. Get lost. I only have a continuity problem. I don't have an ego problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a guilt problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a confusion problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an anguish problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't need to work on any of those problems except the continuity problem. And nobody else does either. Nobody else does either, ego. Nobody needs to work on any problem other than the continuity problem, period. The Holy Spirit will take care of everything in this universe that needs to happen. The Holy Spirit can run the entire universe without us doing anything. Absolutely. So we can keep the familiarity of, I mean, this is the battleground here of all our problems. We can keep at least the familiar trees, forms, whatever, you know, that we're used to. It's just no longer a problem for us. It's not problematical. Paradise looks very much like this world. Paradise realm, the death-free realm, the problem-free realm. Except that there's no problems there. There's nothing rots, nothing decays. No death, no accidents, no sickness. Everything there is just, you know, eternally flawless. It's just incredibly beautiful and just amazing. So nobody has to struggle with any of the problems of the ego. See, I thought if I could solve all this conflict with the ego, I could help everybody else get free of it too. But I was being tricked by the ego into defending myself and arguing with it, trying to defeat the ego, you know, in argument and show the ego how it's wrong and how that would, no, that's not the way. It's not the way at all, because as long as we have that continuity problem, we won't wake up, and which means the ego can make us feel that we're deceitful because we're claiming we want to wake up and we're not doing it, which means we feel guilty, we feel like we're being trying to trick the ego, feel guilty about it, get conflicted, and then we get into the position of feeling we need to give the ego what it wants, you know, and then we feel that we've been found out to be bad, you know, we're bad, we're terrible, we're not honest with the ego. The ego's got you. As long as you don't recognize you have a continuity problem, that's the only problem you have, the ego has got you. It really has got you. And it knows it's got you, which is why it tries to keep you away from this realization, recognition of how I only have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. So this is the way that I have, you know, that I'm compatible with, having gone through what I've gone through, seeing the totality of the problems that we have and how they're structured and why it's so difficult for us, etc. And, you know, I don't want any part of, you know, the instant enlightenment thing. Come on, come on, come to the guru. Wake up right now. What's the matter with you? What, you got a problem? No, come on, just wake up. Wake up, wake up. You don't have any problems, just wake up. I say, no, don't do it that way. I say, yes, you do have a problem. In fact, you have such a severe problem that the other problems, you don't have any time to spend on them. Not important. You have a continuity problem. Very severe continuity problem. Focus on that. Forget about the other problems. Just focus on that one problem. That's the right way to go about it. But of course, if you're a guru and you want everybody to be enlightened so you can show what a great guru you are, you'll say, come to me, come on, come on, come on, come on, everybody. Wake up right now. Come on, wake up, wake up, wake up. Come on, what's the matter with you? Can't you wake up? Come on, come on. You don't like me, you don't love me, I'm not a good enough guru for you. Come on, wake up, wake up, wake up. Why can't you wake up right now? You really want to awaken? Are you sure you want to? Oh yes, I do. Well, come on, what's holding you back? I'm here. Jump into the arms of love. that's very problematical, actually. Very problematical. The real gurus don't do it that way. The real guru says, look, you got a severe problem. You have a severe continuity problem. I don't need you to wake up for my sake. I don't need you to wake up to prove I'm awake or a great guru. Forget it. I'm not on a guru ego trip at all. You have a severe continuity problem. Maybe the rest of your life you'll be working on it, okay? So get to work right now. That is the real guru. That's the one you trust. That's Anandamaya Ma, Sri Anandamaya Ma, real guru. Real guru. Golden, okay? Absolutely golden. no spiritual ego whatsoever. Come to her from enlightenment to enlightenment. She just, so what's your spiritual practice like? She'd say. You say, well, I thought you'd enlighten me. She says, are you kidding? You know, you got to get to work. All right, you got a severe continuity problem. You got to get started. You know, what are you talking about? I give right spiritual practice. You got to get started. How often do you practice? Once a week? She'd say, I don't know. Well, why don't you get practicing once a week? Okay, I want you to practice once a week. How long do you practice? I don't know. Well, how about 10 minutes once a week? Okay. And they said, I thought you were a guru and you were going to enlighten me. She say, why don't you get started on your practice, okay? Try that. If you think I'm such a great guru, she'd say, then why don't you listen to my advice? That's what she said. She wouldn't say, oh, well, you're not good enough. If you love me enough and thought I was a great guru, you should be able to awaken in my presence. My presence is so enlightening, you should be able to wake up right this moment. What's the matter with you? How come you're not waking up? I'm kind of a little bit offended by it, actually, you know. You know, you say that you're here to love me, and you're bowing to my worship, bowing to my feet, and you're not waking up. I think maybe you're a charlatan. I think maybe you're not a real devotee. And I said, no. Just the opposite. She'd say, well, if you think I'm such a great guru, why don't you follow my advice and get practicing? That is exactly what she said. Everybody went to her and said, Ma, please give me enlightenment. And she'd say, she'd play with it, you know. She was very gentle with everybody, but she says, you sure you're ready for enlightenment? You know, oh yeah. That's what I want. You sure that's what you want? yeah, and she said, well, then she'd bring to light how they were, didn't really want it. She says, well, so you trust me, she say, entirely? Of course, Ma, I trust you. Okay, she say, all right. What I want you to do before the enlightenment, I want you to do some practice, you know, to get ready for it, a little bit more ready for it. You trust what I trust me? And he said, well, yeah, I trust you. Well, if you trust me with waking you from your coma, don't you trust me then? If I tell you to, could you do a little exercise to get ready for it? Don't you trust me with that? And then it's, but I didn't come here for that. I came here for enlightenment. She said, well, I mean, you don't trust me, because I tell you need to do this practice first. Get ready for it. Put on the wedding garment, Jesus said. Jesus' parables were all about the wedding garment. He would use the same way. Practice. He says, don't come to the wedding without a wedding garment. Wedding garment is symbolizing practice. Practice. Don't come to the wedding without a wedding garment. You'll be thrown out into the darkness, you know. Don't come to the guru for enlightenment. Come unless you're absolutely ready. And who of us is? And if we do right spiritual practice, the vision of oneness will dawn on us. Will dawn on us, for sure. Of its own accord. We don't need to be zapped by Shakti. We don't need to get this, you know, the Shakti zapped by the Shakti. Shakti blast, you know, these Shakti gurus, you know. Oh, I just, you know, give me a hit of enlightenment, guru, zap, you know, that kind of stuff. Nah, I never did that. Real gurus don't do that. They say, what are you coming to me? I'm nothing. I mean, I can't give you enlightenment. Why are you coming to see me? And if you say, well, you know, I really want to free myself from this trap I'm in. I want to go in the direction of God. I want a soft awakening. I've got a severe continuity problem. Could you suggest, you know, could you help motivate me for some right spiritual practice? And help me, you know, motivate me to practice better in something. And then they'll say, sure. Of course. Yeah, and then they'll ask you about your practice and say, okay, that's good. Okay, now, you know, the way, if you could make it a little better, if you did it like this way. She's an expert in all spiritual practices, absolute expert. So whoever asked her for that, she'd tell them, here's how you can make your practice a little better, amp it up a little bit. That is the real guru, right there. No question. First time I saw Sri Sri Anandamayi on a video, instantly I realized that is the real guru. That's a real guru. Like that. But instantly, it didn't even take a second. You know, I just, whoa, that's a real guru. I said, there is a real guru. I said, I've never, wow. And it was like, whoa. And of course, we're scared of real gurus because we know they're not going to give us enlightenment. They're going to tell us to practice more. And that doesn't please the ego. So we're afraid to see a real guru because the ego's going to be really mad at us. Why are you going to see that guru? They can't enlighten you. Do they enlighten you? No. Charlatan. If they're a real guru, they can give you enlightenment. Just like that, you know, come on. Why are you going to see a guru like that? They told you to spend more time, blah, blah, blah. I don't have a weight problem. I've got a continuity problem. I don't have an ego problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an existential problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a survival problem. I only have a continuity problem. What the heck is that? That's a bunch of mumbo jumbo. You're wasting your time. What, if they're a real guru, they give you the Shaktipat, waking up your third eye, blast the kundalini up your spine, and you'd be in the seventh heaven. And you wouldn't even, you know, if you finished, man, you made it, just like that. That's a real guru. They, no problem. Or they give you some breathing exercise, you huff and you puff and you know, you give yourself some kind of hyperoxygen thing. And they told you to say this mumbo jumbo. What is that? You know, this, the ego hates it. Very skeptical. It's just, you're stupid to go to that kind of guru. What's the matter with you? What's the matter? You're really lost soul, you know? And it starts, you know, mocking you. The ego will mock you. So, of course, we're like scared of it. You know, it's like, wow. Yeah, I went all the way to India and had Sri Sri Anandamayi tell me to go back to America and practice my Christian, you know, prayers more, which is, you know, probably what she would say. You travel all the way to Dehradun and to her ashram, and you find her there, and you finally get an audience, and she says, "Well, what's your religion? I'm a Christian. Okay, what's your practice?" She says, "This is what I practice." And she says, "Okay, well, go back home and practice it more, practice it better. And here's a suggestion: you know, try to do it in the morning for an hour, and the evening for an hour, every day." You know, that's all she'd say. You know, and you say, I came all the way to India. So you go back home and say, what, did you saw the guru? Where's the grace? Did you get enlightened? No, he just said to say the Lord's Prayer, you know, for an hour in the morning and the evening, or whatever, you know, whatever Christian prayer is doing. And they say, well, what are you talking about? I thought she's some Hindu or something, and you didn't get, you know, you're not, where's the enlightenment? Come on, I thought you'd be a guru. Where's the enlightenment? No enlightenment. Just, I feel like I'm going in the right direction with my practice. She said, I'm going in the right direction. I just need to do more of it, more effective prayer. You know, that's it. That's all she told you? Yeah, that's it. Now, come on, she gave you some secret. What's the secret? Come on, you can tell us. Come on, tell us the secrets. You got enlightened, right? You at least you saw enlightenment or something? Or come on. No. I did feel something totally profound. There's no question about it. It was just, you know, incredible presence. But what I got was, I need to practice more. That's it. Basically, it doesn't matter what religion you are. You go to the real guru, they say, whatever practice that you're comfortable with that's working, has traction for you, just do that. Do more of it. Do it better. Keep the momentum going. Don't let the fire go out. Keep throwing more and more wood on the fire. Keep building the fire. Keep building the fire. That's it. That is it. So now you know the secret. There is no secret. But there is great techniques to use. Continuity technique is a great technique. Great technique. It absolutely pulls the rug out from under the ego. Just pulls it out. And because you say, ego, I got a worse problem. The problems you're trying to give me. Go peddle your glass beads somewhere else. I haven't put good at those problems. I can't spend my time on those problems. Those are little problems, ego. Even death is a little problem, ego. I got a bigger problem than death. I got a continuity problem because I'm afraid of waking up from this coma of projection and forgetfulness of reality. That's a problem, ego. Death is not even a problem. Sickness, death, all that stuff is ridiculous. Go peddle your glass beads somewhere else. I'm not interested in that nonsense. That's what you can do. You can tell the ego off like that. Get out of here. Get your sorry chintzy stuff out of here. Chintzy problems out of here. I got a real problem. I have a real problem. There's a continuity problem. That's a problem. I'm telling you. That is a problem, right? It is. Because we have tried to uncreate creation. And we have been in this fog of fantasy and forgetfulness for so long. We are really afraid to come out of it. So we need the soft landing. We need the soft landing. Absolutely go to the bank on that. We need the vision of oneness. It's a soft landing. Very soft landing. And of course the ego says, if you could do that, you should be able to wake up right away. No. I have a continuity problem. I can't wake up right away. I have to have a soft landing. I need this medicine. This is medicine I need. It takes me out of the coma gently, gently, gently. Well, you'll never be a guru. Fine. The ego doesn't even know what a guru is, you know. Gurus just... The top gurus really can handle a heavy workload for sure. Really. Absolutely. We can be, you know, guru interns, you know. Be guru intern. Sure, I'm interning to be a guru, but I'm not a guru. No, I'm interning. You know, when you're fighting in the vision of oneness, you're interning. You're just an intern. You're just an intern. I'm just an intern. I'm not even an intern yet, but you can say that. I'm preparing to be an intern. I'm studying to be an intern guru. You know, an intern savior. Just an intern. Just, you know, learning how to shoulder the workload a little bit, right? But the top notch ones, you know, like a Shankara, you know, for example, the Jesus, whatever, they can handle a heavy, heavy workload, really. It's very impressive what they can do. We're not anywhere close to that, and we don't need to be. We don't need to be. Let the heavyweights handle, let the surgeons handle the coma, waking from the coma. Let the experts. We're just interns there, like observing. You know, like when you see in hospitals, you have the interns come in. They observe the surgery, right? They observe the surgery is all they're doing. That's all we need to do at this point, is just observe the surgery. Now, I just used Sri Sri Anandamayi as an example because we have video of her and a lot of pictures and books written about her, everything she did, and audio tape and stuff. So we can study that. It's something we can study, you know, that's very compelling. Whereas like Shankara, well, you know, we don't have video, pictures, audio, seeing his body, the body language, how he talks with people, how, you know, all that stuff was seen back then. But in today's modern age, we kind of like to see some video on it, you know. I want some audio. I want some video. I want some books. I want somebody who's living today, who knew them, who wrote down books, you know. There's a lot of authors that visit her. from the West. They wrote books about her, about their experiences, and they say, hey, yeah, for sure, this is a heavyweight. This is a real heavyweight. And so we got all this testimony, modern testimony, which we all, because of perception, tend to believe in modern testimony, what is nearer to us more than what is farther away. And what is farther away, we tend to say, well, I'm not sure. That has to do with the personality and with perception. That's an issue we have. So the ego says, nah, there's only one teacher, and the teacher came a long, long time ago, and you'll never get another one. Well, that suits the ego's purposes, because the further in time it gets away, the more the ego is able to distort it, the more power the ego has to distort. That is a fact. That is a fact. The further it recedes in time. So it's very helpful to have someone very fresh to look at, to see, you know, a heavyweight is very fresh. Then you can say, hey, ego, this is right here. Look at this, you know, you're done for, ego. This is the drill deal, and you're a liar. You know, you've been distorting, ego. You have been distorting the historical record. The ego is very good at distorting the historical record because of our problem with projection. Our whim to uncreate creation gives rise to projection. Projection gives rise to perception. Perception gives rise to personality. Personality gives rise to judgment. Okay, judgment gives rise to distortion. That's it. And the further in time or space anything is from us, automatically that the projection personality complex and judgment, projection, perception, personality, judgment complex automatically distorts it. Automatically, without us being even aware of it hardly. Only very subliminally are we aware of it. Very faintly almost. It's there, but like a faint breeze. We might miss it. This faint breeze is distorting time and space. All space, time and space relationships we have are distorted relationships. All of it. It's all judgmental. So the further in time and space something gets from us, the ego just is easier and easier and easier and easier to distort it. And now we're getting so many distortions about Jesus in the modern times, secular times. Oh, he's just a social activist rabbi, you know. Nice guy. He was fighting for, you know, equality, or he was a social justice guy. That's what really was about. All this other stuff is, that's the distortions of time and space. He was really just a social activist. Now, the ego can flip-flop things on us. So it projects us and says, no, the truth about it is a distortion, the ego says, and the distortion is actually the truth about it. And that's what's happening in the modern world with Jesus, is the truth about Jesus, now they're flipping it entirely, flipping it. So he was just a social activist. I mean, it seems like every magazine just has to have Jesus on their cover, you know, all these magazines from the ego promotes and publishes. Redefining Jesus, redefining. Now, it may seem that I did redefining in this video, but what I really did was I turned it back to the real definition of what really happened, okay? Absolutely. I mean, what Jesus did was just incredible, that he is willing to do that and bring to light the entire deception of the ego at its very core, and let us know, this is what you're up against. This is what you are up against. You know, that is what he did, Jesus did. This is what you're up against. And he knows exactly how to get free of it. You know, perfect teacher, you see. But in today's world, it's now become this ridiculous idolatrous caricature of the ego idolaters. The way they want to see Jesus is they saying, oh, sure, what the ego says is, oh, sure, we love Jesus. Absolutely, Jesus is a great guy, wonderful. He really cared about the poor people. Yeah, he really cared about the poor people. He cared about the underprivileged people. He was all about equality, you know, equal distribution of food and wealth. And he was really the first genuine socialist, actually. You know, just a great guy. I mean, it's just, I wish we could get people to really, all these crazy Christians who think that he was crucified and then resurrected from the dead and was able to save us from the clutches of the ego by exposing the ego as a murderer and a deceiver and a liar from the very beginning, turn us to the Holy Spirit. All those are people that are like fanatically distorting us all to wealth distribution. That is what they're saying. And if you think that Jesus is the Savior that wants us to do right spiritual practice and prayer and to accept the vision of oneness and trust in the Holy Spirit, you're like distorting. Time and space has caused you to distort all this stuff. You don't get that he was just this nice rabbi socialist who understood right economic principles back at that time. And it was just a little bit ahead of his time. And the Roman Empire didn't like him because it didn't want these socialist policies to be implemented in the Roman Empire. So we're finally catching up to Jesus and understanding of what the spiritual masters really want in this world, which is proper distribution of goods and services throughout the world, to make sure that we're all equal, you know, universal health care, universal currency, universal access, no discrimination based on anything whatsoever, and freedom to watch Hollywood movies and productions 24 hours a day. Thank you very much. Jesus was just getting us ready for all this. And the times that he talked about are here now. The wonderful golden age is here now. You got 1,000 channels, and 10,000 more channels are coming on your television set. And you get to listen to all this wonderful raucous music 24 hours a day. And you're in this beautiful hedonistic paradise. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. The gospel of prosperity is what Jesus was teaching. He wanted you to be prosperous here. He wanted to make sure that you had everything that you wanted. He was just a social prosperity guru. He was the first prosperity guru. That's what they're saying. Oh yeah, you're just here to tell us, you know what, you deserve everything here. You deserve to have the best car and a nice house. You deserve to have good, happy relationships. You deserve nice clothes. You deserve the life you want. He was the first principle of attraction guru. He was just teaching us the laws of attraction, right? The laws of wealth, the laws of success. That's all he was. He was the first psychologist, the first psychiatrist, the first prosperity guru, the first this, there have been thousands and thousands of interpretations of what Jesus was. Every age has their new interpretation, which just actually, basically, makes Jesus into a figurehead of what the ego wants the age to be like. That's all they're doing. It's just the ego. Just the ego. You go to Jesus now, and Jesus says, what's your practice? How much are you practicing? Practice more. Do more intense practicing. But I thought, Jesus, you're going to take my sins away. You need the vision of oneness to do that. You start practicing. That's all Jesus would say. Start practicing. Well, why are you not practicing? That's all. Put on your wedding. Where's your wedding garment? I don't see your wedding garment. No. That's it. We got Jesus all hyped up. We got the gurus all hyped up. These gurus are all the same. You know, the great gurus are all the same. You go to Shankar, you go to Buddha, same. Don't go out there trying to change the world. What's your practice? But Jesus, I want to build a hospital. Jesus says, fine, but how about your spiritual practice? You need the vision of oneness. Don't you realize that perception, that project, you're caught in this bind with a terrible continuity problem of projection, perception, personality, judgment, ego, right? Continuity problem. Don't you realize you need a soft awakening? You need the vision of oneness. How are you going to get that if you don't practice? You don't rehearse for it. You need a wedding rehearsal. So you need to get your wedding garment on before the wedding. So you need to rehearse. Come on. So you need to start practicing, right? But, you know, I thought you were going to take all my sins. I'd be happy ever after, take my sins away. Need to practice. Yeah, you need to practice. You're not ready. You got a severe continuity problem. Wow, maybe this is not Jesus, you'd say. Maybe this is an imposter. You go to see real Jesus, you think the eagles would say, he's an imposter, imposter. How come he didn't take your sins away? How come you're not in seventh heaven right now? Must be an imposter. What do you mean he told you to practice? Are you kidding me? What do you mean he didn't try to dissolve your emotional complexes and free you from your traumas and get you to wake up right? What are you talking about? He tell you to practice. Well, I don't have a trauma problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have any trauma problem. I only have a continuity problem. But my continuity problem is very severe, but the vision of oneness resolves it for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. This trauma problem has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Huh? That's what? What? Well, crazy. It's an imposter. Go find the real Jesus. That's exactly how it would go. Jesus is not here to... No guru comes here to try and catapult us back out of our coma. He's here to gently awaken us from our coma. They're the doctors. They're the real doctors who know how to gently awaken us from our coma, severe coma, our severe complex. We have a severe complex, severe problem with continuity. So, you know, this spiritual romanticism has got to, you got to put it in the closet with your LPs, you know, the old records, and just put it back, put it in the closet there, just let it collect some dust, let it collect dust. You don't have to throw it away. All right. So, just put it in the closet, let it collect dust, and start practicing. It's just like that, all right? This day as it is totally free of all specialness. Thanks for watching. That's it.